Hello students, looking at current affairs for 1st June, the news items picked up from the Hindu newspaper are these 20. We'll look at them in detail. The first one, Amit Shah gets home in new cabinet. So the new cabinet has been formed by the Modi government. The new Modi government has been formed and the new cabinet has many new faces too. BJP National President Amit Shah has now been allotted the Home Ministry and former Foreign Secretary S. Jaishankar has been made the External Affairs Minister. So these are two new faces, the two topmost faces after the Prime Minister. Then former Defence Minister Nirmala Sitharaman has now been made the Finance Minister. And former Home Minister Rajnath Singh has now become the Defence Minister. Also many ministers have retained their portfolios too. Those who were there in the first Modi government, like Senior Minister Nitin Gadkari, he continues to be the Minister for Road Transport and Highways and has got an additional Ministry of Micro, Small and Medium Enterprises. Ravi Shankar Prasad, he also continues to be the Law Minister along with IT and Telecom along with it. So, Railway Minister Piyush Goyal also retains charge of Railway Ministry as well as addition of Ministry of Commerce too. So, this is there. Some of the earlier ministers have been dropped too, as is evident. So, there is a newly created ministry too. You should know about that. That is called Jal Shakti Ministry. The BJP's manifesto, which it launched in April 2019, spoke of this ministry. And it said the government would give priority to this ministry. So here you can see the portfolios of 24 cabinet ministers has been announced. That is detailed out here. Then next is GDP growth slumps to 5.8%. So India's GDP growth from Jan to March 2019, the last quarter of the financial year, was 5.8%, which has taken down the overall full year growth to 5-year low at 6.8%. Also, unemployment rate in the country has risen to a 45-year high of 6.1% in 2017-18, according to official data released on the first day of second term of Modi government. So, External Economic Affairs Secretary Subhash Chandra Garg said that the slowdown in the last quarter has been due to temporary factors, he says, such as liquidity crunch. In the NBFC sector also, we saw stress in the NBFC sector affecting consumption finance, and he says this is temporary. So, he also said that this is likely to continue in the April to June quarter too, means the first quarter of the next financial year, and demand will pick up in the second quarter onwards. Also, on the unemployment data which has been released, the draft, actually a leaked version had come up earlier itself of this NSSO data, and which had claimed that joblessness in the country is at a 45-year high, but now it has been officially released, and the government's justification is that a new design and a new matrix has been used for the calculation of unemployment, so that is why it is unfair to compare it with the past. So this 45-year high is your interpretation, says the statistics secretary. Here you can see, but what is the new method or new matrix used, new design used, has not been detailed out. So here you can see the quarterly GDP growth shown over the last few quarters, and this is the present figure, which is at a significant low over the quarters. And this is regarding joblessness. India's unemployment stood at 6.1% in 2017-18. And rural-urban unemployment is also shown here. Urban unemployment is much higher at 7.8%. Government says new methodology followed and cannot compare data with earlier surveys. Then next is India lifts curbs on airspace. So post the Balakot airstrike, which took place on 27th February 2019, India and Pakistan both placed restrictions on the airspace for respective countries. So now India has taken the initiative and it will provide a relief to thousands of air travelers which have been affected due to the closure of airspace by India. So Pakistan will be allowed to access India's airspace now, and now they say the ball is in Pakistan's court. Pakistan should also remove the restrictions. So this was imposed by Indian Air Force on 27 February 2019. This has been removed now. So IAF has communicated this decision to even the Airports Authority of India. So it was Pakistan which initiated this and shut the airspace for all flights on 27th Feb following the Indian Air Force strike on the Jaish-e-Mohammed camp in Balakot in Pakistan. So it is said, according to Indian officials, 11 entry and exit points which are located between Jammu and Kashmir and Gujarat have been closed for flights to and from Pakistan. So this is the case, but now the restrictions from Indian side has been removed. The government officials also said that Airport Authority of India has written to UN's Aviation Watchdog, International Civil Aviation Organization, as well as countries like Pakistan, Afghanistan, Oman and Iran, informing them about the decision. So Pakistan also has gradually opened its airspace for most airlines, barring those entering the country from its eastern border after traversing India. So now Pakistan actually on May 29 extended this 3-month long ban for flights from and through India till June 15. So we'll have to wait and watch what next step Pakistan would take. So the ban is actually valid till June 15 from Pakistan's side. And it is said as many as 6 international airlines have been forced to cancel a total of 33 weekly flights to Delhi due to this ban by Pakistan. Their neighbors, India and Pakistan. So, of course, it would affect if airspace is closed for, you know, flights coming from or to going to India. And vice versa too. So, because there were restrictions on airspace, rerouting had to take place, and international travelers and airlines from India, for them, the travel time increased from Delhi to Europe by at least 2 hours. There were baggage curves on Mumbai-New York routes also introduced. Extra cost, you know, was there, and the burden on airlines due to stopovers and increased flying time was evident. Then next is, below normal rainfall likely northwest northeast, says Indian Meteorological Department. So a week before the onset of southwest monsoon is expected to reach Kerala coast by June 6. So a week before this, now Indian Meteorological Department has said that there will be normal rain pre-season in the country as a whole, and the country would receive 96% of the long period average rainfall, which is in the normal range. Northwest India will get 94% of the average, while Northeast India will receive only 91% of average rainfall. So both these will fall under below normal category. Means there will be normal rainfall throughout India, but Northwest and Northeast India will have below normal rainfall. So there are El Nino conditions, weak El Nino conditions presently prevailing too. And El Nino, strong El Nino has adverse effect on monsoon, but since the El Nino conditions are weak and they may continue to be weak for some time, it is said that the monsoon season would be normal in the country. So normal monsoon means country gets 96 to 104% of the normal rainfall of the long period average. So what is this long period average also you should know, that is the average rainfall which we get. So long period average value is actually 89 centimeter rainfall received. And you can see the categorization also given here. Excess rainfall is above 110% of long period average, above normal, normal, below normal, and deficient is shown here. So these figures are old, forecast probability are old figures, but at least you should know this standard terminologies, long period average, and what do each of these terminologies mean, the rainfall range. So that's what we were talking of. So, what is normal monsoon, the range that is shown here, and also below normal monsoon, the range is shown here. So, 96 to 104 is normal, 90 to 96 is below normal. And then we also have above normal and excess. Also, the entire model of Indian Meteorological Department has a model error. So error is of plus minus 8%. So, whatever is predicted, there is a range of plus minus 8% error margin. Also, the IMD has given region-wise rainfall also, how much rainfall it would get. So, Northwest India, it is 94%. Central India, it says 100%. 97% of normal rainfall, that is of long period average, over South Indian Peninsula. And Northeast, 91%, as we just discussed earlier too. Then next is, Supreme Court asks Maharashtra to revise postgraduate merit list sans economically weaker sections quota. So, economically weaker sections quota has been announced by the central government and states have initiated implementing it. So, Maharashtra state government also took the initiative and provided for 10% economically weaker sections quota. But then this has been challenged in the court, and the Supreme Court directed the Maharashtra government to not implement this from the present academic year. So, this Maharashtra government wanted to implement this for medical courses, for admissions in postgraduate medical courses. So the Supreme Court had stayed the Maharashtra government's notification which it had issued for providing this economically weaker sections quota in February and March 2019. The Supreme Court stayed these notifications saying that unless the Medical Council of India increases the number of seats, the quota should not be implemented. So if the seats are increased, then whatever is the present number of seats which general category is getting, that would not be affected at least. So that's the idea. So increase the number of seats and then implement the quota was what the Supreme Court stated. So Medical Council of India has to increase the number of seats, but this has not been done yet. And Maharashtra government, when it initiated admission process for postgraduate medical courses, it made a provision for this 10% AWS quota. So this was provided for 25 students. So Supreme Court has now directed the Maharashtra government to remove these seats allotted to economically weaker sections and complete the counseling process with the revised merit list. So it has to complete the counseling process by June 4, otherwise it face adverse consequences. The Supreme Court pulled up the government for overreaching its order against the implementation of this quota. So when the court has specifically mentioned that it should not implement the quota, still Maharashtra government went ahead and provided for it. So this is the detail given out here about this case. So this economically weaker sections quota of 10% can be delayed by a year by 2020. So the number of seats need to be increased is what is being done. It is estimated that 25% increase in seats may be necessary to accommodate this 10% quota. Steps need to be taken for that. And what is this 10% reservation? The criteria for economically weaker section, you can see there are various criteria, 5 points mentioned here. So first point is you have household income of less than 8 lakh a year. So it is said that at least 95% of Indians earn less than 8 lakh a year. Then second is you have agricultural land of less than 5 acres. It is said 86% land holding in India is under this category. So this is the percentage of population who is eligible for this 10% quota. Third is you have a household smaller than 1000 square feet. It is said at least 80% of households in India have houses smaller than 500 square feet, leave alone 1000 square feet. So here also huge population comes in this 10% quota criteria. And fourth point is have a residential plot smaller than 100 yards in a municipality. For this, the data was not available. And also fifth point is a residential plot of less than 200 yards in non-notified municipality. So this is the eligibility criteria detailed out here. Also, you should know that Indira Sawhney case of the Supreme Court judgment, in this judgment, the Supreme Court had stated that reservation cannot exceed 50%. But the reservation which we have presently, ST reservation is of 7.5%, SC 15%, OBC 27%, and economically weaker section have been provided for this 10% now. So earlier itself, without economically weaker section, we had reached this limit of 50%. It was 49.5% reservation being provided, but now it has exceeded and become 59.5% with 10% quota for EWS. So Indira Sawhney judgment has been violated as such. So a constitutional amendment bill, it was said, was required to implement this, and the government has passed this constitutional amendment bill providing for reservation, 10% reservation for economically weaker section. Then next is Admiral Karambir Singh takes over as Navy Chief. So Admiral Karambir Singh assumed office as the 24th Chief of Naval Staff. So he will take over from Admiral Sunil Lamba, who has stepped down upon retirement. So this appointment of Admiral Karambir Singh, you should know, had been mired in controversy because another senior official challenged this appointment. That was Vice Admiral Bimal Verma. So he is the chief of Andaman and Nicobar based Tri-Service Command. It had approached the Armed Forces Tribunal questioning the appointment. He said that he was the senior most naval officer after Admiral Lanba. So why was he superseded and Admiral Karambir Singh appointed? So the Defence Ministry had rejected his petition. So the Armed Forces Tribunal has been approached, and Armed Forces Tribunal has asked the government to submit all files related to the selection process now. So Defence Ministry has to give these details. The government has to provide the details. So the case is still going on. Armed Forces Tribunal has said July 17 is the next date for the hearing, and because government had sought more time. But then at the same time, Armed Forces Tribunal allowed Admiral Karambir Singh to assume the charge as well too. Also, Army and Air Force will see change of guard later in 2019 too. The next is NGT raps states for not curbing pollution in Ganga. So the National Green Tribunal has imposed a penalty of rupees 25 lakh each on the three states, that is Bihar, Jharkhand and West Bengal, for not taking adequate steps to curb pollution of river Ganga. So National Green Tribunal had directed the states to provide detailed plans, while West Bengal, Bihar and Jharkhand did not even represent themselves in spite of the orders passed by the tribunal. So this has been strongly disapproved by the National Green Tribunal. So it also says there has been no progress in terms of completion of sewage treatment infrastructure projects in the three states. Bihar has done none. West Bengal has completed only 3 out of 22 projects. So on the basis of this, the National Green Tribunal has directed the states to deposit the penalty amount of 25 lakh each within a month with Central Pollution Control Board, and this money may be used to may be spent on restoration of the environment. Here you can see it is said that the discharge of effluents is an offense and governments have to take care of that. So UP government also, which through which river Ganga passes, so UP government has also been asked to prohibit industrial activity that resulted in pollution. So UP chief secretary, it is said, may personally monitor and ensure zero tolerance approach to pollution of river Ganga. So this is what the National Green Tribunal bench stated too. So you should know about the National Green Tribunal too. It has been established in 2010 under National Green Tribunal Act. Article 21 of the Constitution provides for, you know, right to healthy environment. So Article 21 basically is right to life. So life means healthy life. So it is a right to healthy environment is also interpreted under it. And to provide for this, National Green Tribunal has been established for effective and expeditious disposal of cases related to environment. So related to environment like conservation of forests, natural resources, or enforcement of any legal right relating to environment, or giving relief and compensation for damages to person or property connected to these cases. So such cases can go before the National Green Tribunal. It is a quasi-judicial body and it does not have to follow the code of civil procedure, CRPC or IPC. It has to follow the due process of law, of course, and principles of natural justice. So it will quickly dispose of the cases within 6 months. It's headquartered in Delhi and has 4 circuit branches too, in Bhopal, Pune, Kolkata and Chennai. This is the National Green Tribunal. It's a statutory body established under the Act, NGT Act in 2010. It comprises of a full-time chairman who should have been a judge of Supreme Court or a Chief Justice of a High Court. And there are at least 10 full-time judicial members under it and at least 10 full-time expert members too. Maximum judicial members can be 20. So here you can see it is disposed of applications and appeals within 6 months. So it is fast-track resolution of environment related cases. Then this is regarding river Ganga. It flows through Uttarakhand in India, Uttarakhand, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Jharkhand and West Bengal, and then enters into Bangladesh. So this is the Ganga basin. Red boundary is the boundary of the Ganga basin. This is the mainstream Ganga river and light blue is its tributaries. And there have been many programs launched for cleaning river Ganga. The present program, Namami Gange program, which is 100% centrally funded program. So it has focus on river Ganga and its tributaries. So you can see, 20,000 crore has been allotted for it, Namami Gange program, for a 5-year period. So it was initiated in 2014-15 itself. And these are regarding earlier programs also launched for cleaning river Ganga, but they had meager resources with them, meager allocation for them. But Namami Gange program had a huge amount allocated for it. The next is US reiterates threat of sanctions over Trump deal. So S-400 Trump missile shield is what India is buying from Russia, and this deal has been signed. We have committed to this in October 2018 to purchase Russian S-400 Trump long range missile defense shield. So this is a deal for $5 billion. So this is not to the liking of USA. USA has passed a law in 2017 called CATSA, Countering America's Adversaries Through Sanctions Act. So under this, sanctions will be imposed against any country which has defense relations with adversaries of America, which include Russia. So Russia, Iran are prominent countries under this. So these sanctions will kick off only when payment starts. So we have not made any payment yet, but the agreement has been signed. And also USA passed another law in 2018 called National Defense Authorization Act. So in this act, the president of USA has been allowed to grant waivers from CATSA sanctions under certain conditions. So this has given hope to India that we may also get waivers, but now USA is reiterating, it had earlier too stated that the sanctions will take place, waiver is not automatic, and it is for the president to decide it on a case to case basis. So it has reiterated that India should not assume that it will get waiver from US sanctions. But then India asserts that S-400 missile defense shield is important for India, which will be beneficial for USA too, because this will also help it counter threats from China. So it is beneficial, and Russian platforms like BrahMos cruise missile also have been beneficial, and USA can't offer comparable anti-access or area denial capabilities. So that is why we went ahead with the S-400 system of Russia, but USA opposes it. So here you should know about the S-400 Triumph deal with Russia. So it's for $5 billion, which comes to around 40,000 crores rupees. So S-400 Triumph features are that it can engage all types of aerial targets, including aircraft, unmanned aerial vehicles, and all types of missiles. It can locate targets at 600 km and can destroy them at 400 km range up to an altitude of 30 km. So the system can engage multiple targets simultaneously too. So possible deployments in India will be in these regions, you can see, with Pakistan and China, borders with Pakistan and China. So this is the missile system. So it is capable of firing different types of missiles to create a layered defense shield. And regarding US sanctions, CATSA sanctions, you should know. So America's CATSA legislation applies sanctions on 39 entities in Russia's defense and intelligence sector, and secondary sanctions on countries engaging in business with them. So countries would be affected because of this CATSA and because of the S-400 Triumph purchase is India, even Turkey, even Vietnam as such. And China is also among the biggest purchasers of Russian arms. So it will also likely face sanctions. Turkey itself is buying S-400. So like India, Turkey is also buying this S-400 air defense system from Russia. And others are for other purchases from Russia. Then next is India to lose preferential trade terms with US. So India is going to lose the preferential trade terms with USA under US GSP, Generalized System of Preferences Program. So India is said to be the largest beneficiary of GSP. So GSP, Generalized System of Preferences, is for developing countries. So developed countries like USA, even European Union has its GSP program. So it means there will be reduced tariffs for goods which are purchased from developing countries. So that is how the developed countries support developing countries. And this is not reciprocal. So developing countries have no obligation to have reduced tariffs. But USA, we see how it is against the trade deficit which USA has with various countries. Like India also has a trade surplus with USA. So that is also not to the liking of USA. And US wants to reduce this gap, and it wants GSP eligibility of India also to be ended. So that is what has been decided on. So India wants to restore the benefits, but that possibility is bleak now because of the trade issues which are already there between India and USA. So it is said India has failed to assure Washington that it would provide equitable and reasonable access to the markets of India. So because India has failed on this count, USA is withdrawing GSP program for India. So similar notification USA has issued for Turkey as well on the same day. And there is 60-day notification period which was initiated, and this statutory 60-day notification period for GSP withdrawal came into effect on May 17. So from May 17 onwards, GSP program for Turkey has been terminated, but not for India. Because US lawmakers had written to the administration, US administration, that the final decision for India should be put on hold. So Indian government had also stated that because of elections going on in India, this was delayed. So it has still not been done. So so that is there. But it is, seems that India is going to finally have GSP withdrawn for itself. It is said that Indian exports to the US worth $5.6 billion are covered by generalized system of preferences. But then the benefit, tariff savings, which India gets because of this trade is of $190 million only. So, but then the crucial Indian sectors are will be impacted if GSP is withdrawn, like textiles, leather, engineering goods, and gems and jewelry. So this is GSP detailed out. It was instituted in 1976 in USA to promote economic growth in developing world. So it provides preferential duty-free access to up to 5,000 products imported from one of their 123 designated beneficiary countries and territories. Then next is double spend on education, says new education, national education policy draft. So a new national education policy draft has been released, and some of the key provisions under this are doubling the percentage of public expenditure on education, setting up of an overarching national education commission. The National Education Commission will also be called as Rashtriya Shiksha Ayog. So this will be an apex body for Indian education, which will be headed by the Prime Minister himself and will be having a mandate beyond the current Human Resource Development Ministry, HRD Ministry. So that is also a provision under the draft National Education Policy. It also proposes to set up National Research Foundation, encourage primary school education in mother tongue, and also incorporate traditional Indian knowledge systems into the curriculum. So this draft National Education Policy has been released on 31st May, and it will be in public domain for viewpoints. For public and expert feedback is sought till June 30. So first National Education Policy came around 3 decades ago, and the last policy was in 1986 with amendments made in 1992. So that is there. So the other key features of the National Education Policy are also detailed out regarding school education. It proposes 3 years of preschool instead of 2, followed by 12 years of schooling. It calls for free and compulsory schooling under right to education from preschool till 12th instead of currently 1st to 8th. Then a nutritious breakfast, perhaps of milk and a banana, for preschool and primary school pupils in addition to midday meal is proposed. Children to be exposed to multiple languages right from foundational stage, made up of preschool and grades 1 and 2. Then higher education, it is set 4 years honors program for undergraduates, general stream courses are proposed. Then there are multiple exit options, like students can leave with a diploma after 2 years or with a graduate degree without honors after 3 years. So 4 years honors program would be there, and a graduate degree if you leave in 3 years, it's a graduate degree. If you leave in 2 years, it's a diploma degree. So multiple exit options are proposed. Then next is North Korea executed envoy after failed Hanoi summit report. So South Korea newspaper has reported that North Korea executed its special envoy to the United States following collapse of the second summit between North Korean leader Kim Jong-un and US President Donald Trump. So the first summit between the two took place in Singapore. You should know about this historic summit. This was the first time that a sitting US president had met North Korean leader. Earlier, we have seen even Clinton, Bill Clinton had met North Korean leader, but that was after he completed his presidency, not while he was the president. So that is the case, the first time a sitting president meeting. So this was the historic summit which took place on June 12th in Singapore at Sentosa Island here. So in this deal, there were no clear commitments. Like North Korea wanted the denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula to be a gradual process. It will give up nuclear weapons and nuclear technology, but USA has imposed sanctions. It wanted gradually, it will denuclearize, and it wanted sanctions also to be removed gradually, but USA insisted that it should completely denuclearize first and later US sanctions will be removed. So without any leeway from USA, with all the sanctions in place, North Korea had no incentive to denuclearize. So that was the deadlock. And at the second summit also, which took place in Hanoi in Vietnam in February 2019, it was 2-day summit, but it was cut short because they could not come up with any agreement. So post this failure of the Hanoi summit, it is said that North Korea executed the special envoy to US. So it is said that he was executed by a firing squad for betraying the supreme leader after he was won over to the US during the pre-summit negotiations. So that is the news coming forth. US Secretary of State Mike Pompeo says that they are trying to verify this claim. Then next is US to hit Mexico with tariffs over migration. So US has announced that it will impose a 5% tariff on all goods from Mexico on June 10. So this will increase to as much as 25%. Means 5% will come from June 10. Then it will increase this tariff on all goods from Mexico will become 10% on 1st July. Then a 5% increase will take place each month. Means 5% it will become from 15 to 20% in on 1st September. And on 1st October it will be 25%. And then it will permanently remain. Tariffs on all goods coming from Mexico to USA would have 25% tariff on them. Unless and until Mexico stops the illegal flow of aliens coming through its territory. So this announcement came on the same day that Mr. Trump kickstarted the process of ratifying the new North American Trade Pact. So this North American Trade Pact, which would replace the NAFTA, North American Free Trade Agreement between USA, Mexico and Canada. So this has been negotiated, but now when such tariffs have been imposed on conditions of illegal flow of aliens into the country, then of course the agreement would be under threat again. So, it is said Mexico sends 80% of its exports to USA. So, Mexico would be significantly affected. Mexican president said that I don't want confrontation. I propose deepening our dialogue to look at other alternatives to the migration problem. And this also happened on this day after US authorities detained the largest single group of migrants they had ever encountered of 1,036 people at US-Mexico border. So, US-Mexico border, even the border wall has significantly been in news. You should know about it too. So, this is the border between USA and Mexico. Mexico lies to the south of USA. So, here, a huge part of the border is not fenced. And even the fence is not sufficient. USA wants to have a border wall built. That is, President Donald Trump wants a border wall built and he wants funding for it from the government. Earlier he said Mexico would fund, but of course Mexico does not have the capability, and it wanted fund coming from US government, US administration, but the legislature has opposed it. We had seen deadlocks with that too. So this is there. And people going into USA from Mexico are also people coming from Guatemala and Honduras, the Central American countries, or El Salvador, from where migrants enter into USA through Mexico. And this is the border wall detailed out here, you can see. So existing fencing is there in some places. So this is to be replaced by border wall, and this is the proposal. So this is shown here. So of course these are geographical barriers as such too, like the Rio Grande Valley, Big Bend, which are located here along US-Mexico border. So cost of extending the fence is of $21.6 billion. It's the border is 3,142 kilometer long, and one third of it is already fenced. Then next is regarding NAFTA too. So North American Free Trade Agreement is to be proposed to be replaced by this new agreement, which has been called United States-Mexico-Canada Agreement, USMCA. NAFTA is a free trade agreement. It allocates most favored nation status to every signatory. There are three signatories: US, Canada, and Mexico. So, it proposes to eliminate tariffs on imports and exports. That's what a free trade agreement is all about. But now we are seeing that USA is imposing tariffs on Mexico specifically, up to 25% on all goods. Of course, it is counter to the free trade agreement which has been negotiated. And this is regarding the trade between USA and Mexico too. You can see Mexico imports to USA is more than the exports. So Mexico has a trade surplus with USA. Canada also has a trade surplus. Deficit is for USA with both Mexico and Canada. That is why US President Donald Trump opted out of NAFTA. Then next is use Huawei and lose access to our data. US warns Germany. So USA has raised the pressure on Western allies in its war of attrition over next generation networks, that is the 5G networks. So every country has been asked to not have any role to play for Chinese telecom company Huawei. It says that this is closely linked to Chinese administration and and confidential and significant data may be going to Chinese authorities if Huawei is involved in 5G networks. So many countries have banned Huawei, but still European countries like Britain and France, they have declined calls to ban Chinese telecom company Huawei, which includes Germany as well. So now US is putting pressure on them, and it is said that if they have Huawei, allow Huawei to have access to data, then USA would cut off crucial intelligence data from these countries. So Mike Pompeo, who is the Secretary of State for USA, he's on a five-day European tour, and he said that every country has a sovereign right. They can take the sovereign decision on which equipment they want to use and whether they want to use Chinese equipment for 5G network. So if they do use for next generation networks, then it will have consequences. So these are the consequences. It will not allow its intelligence data to be accessible to these countries. So this is there, you can see. So this is the timeline in 2018, how United States partnership with AT&T of Huawei fell through. Then in August 2018, Australia banned Huawei from its 5G infrastructure over national security concerns. New Zealand has banned. British Telecom also dropped Huawei from 4G rollout. So USA has been urging its allies to shun Huawei. And this is regarding the telecom giant Huawei of China. So its smartphone market share is also increasing over the years. The next is, won't give up search for Budapest victim, Seoul. So South Korea has vowed not to give up hope in the search of 21 people still missing after the sightseeing boat carrying mainly South Korean tourists sank on Danube River on 29th May 2019. So they were swallowed by the Danube River just seconds after it collided with a much larger cruise ship while it was raining in the region. They were on a European tour, and you can see these tourists sank. Only 7 people are said to have survived. 21 are missing, and South Korea says it will continue to search for them even 2 days after the incident. So you should know about Danube River too here. It flows through many European countries. Its flow is shown here. You can see from Germany to here, you can see Austria, and it was in Budapest in Hungary where the incident took place. This is Slovakia, Bratislava. So these are the cities also located along the border. The next is, tight-fisted center meets deficit target. So fiscal deficit for 2018-19 has come to 3.39% of GDP, marginally lower than 3.4% of GDP, which was the target in the revised estimates of the budget. So this has been because of lower expenditure and increase in non-tax revenue. But overall tax revenue has been low and expenditure has been lowered down to meet the fiscal deficit target. So fiscal deficit target was actually of 3.3%, but it was revised upward to 3.4% in 2018-19 budget because of the extra spending which the government had to undertake on account of schemes for farmers. So fiscal deficit basically is the difference between expenditure and revenue. So whatever is the government expenditure and the revenue, when the expenditure is more than revenue, there's a deficit. So how much can be the fiscal deficit? There's a limit to it. And there's a target specifically provided because we have to reduce the fiscal deficit. So this is the case. You should know about the terminology too. So there are two sides, revenues and expenditure. So receipts and expenditure basically. So government receipts, tax receipts, non-tax receipts and capital receipts are the major receipts. And expenses can be in plan, non-plan expenses, which actually is an old classification which no longer applies. But considering all the expenditures, capital and revenue expenditures, they have to be balanced. So of course, to balance them, maybe we may have to take debts when the receipts are not sufficient. So these debts as such, which we take on any, that actually becomes government borrowing. So this is how much debt we have taken is actually the fiscal deficit. Because we have to balance. When expenditure is more, we have to somehow make provision for it. So that is done through debts. So that is the fiscal deficit. So we have initiated the steps to contain fiscal deficit. So we had the Fiscal Responsibility and Budget Management Act, which was providing for reducing fiscal deficit. But then the plan went haywire when the global financial crisis emerged in 2008-09. So later we have been trying again to eliminate and to restrict fiscal deficit. So, NK Singh committee was established to provide recommendations to again rein in the provisions, and it called for tightening the FRBM Act, and the targets which it provided are mentioned here. So, it seeks to place stringent control over central and state government spending. So, it asked to set up a 3-member fiscal council as such. These are the recommendations of the NK Singh committee. So, these are the targets which it called for financial year 2020, fiscal deficit target should be of 3%, then 2.8%, then 2.5%. Revenue deficit is of revenue expenditure. So, revenue and capital are two aspects. So, capital expenditure and capital receipts have to be balanced, and revenue expenditure and revenue receipts have to be balanced too. So, at least for revenue deficit, it should be brought significantly down. So, these are the targets which it provided for. So, these are the recommendations. Government, as you can see, financial year 2019, we have 3.4% target, and even for financial year 2020, though NK Singh committee recommended 3%, we have it at 3.4% for 2019-22. So, the budget, the government has provided, budgeted at fiscal deficit at 3.4% of GDP. These are some of the other recommendations which NK Singh committee gave on the issue. So, this is shown here. Debt to GDP ratio also, how it has been proposed, and how fiscal deficit also has to be brought down according to NK Singh committee recommendation. Then next is Google to curb third-party access. So, there are growing concerns across the globe over data privacy and security. So, in this context, Google has announced that it will further tighten guidelines for third-party developers having access to user data from Chrome extensions and Google Drive. So, Chrome web stores offer around 1.8 lakh extensions, and nearly half of all Chrome desktop users actively use these extensions to customize their browsers. So, now Google will tighten regulations, guidelines for third-party developers. Also, it is said that Google would extend the incognito mode, which prevents users' browsing history from being stored to products like Google Search and Google Maps. Then next is Philippines returns trash to Canada. So, this was in news. Philippines had asked Canada to take back the trash, containers, garbage containers, which it had shipped Philippines for recycling as such. So, here Philippines says that we do not want this trash and Canada should take it back, and it had threatened that if Canada does not take it back, we will dump this garbage in territorial waters of Canada. So, now 69 shipping containers containing garbage have been loaded on the cargo vessel and have begun their trip to Canada. So, Philippines is asking Canada to take back its trash, and many other countries also, especially in Southeast Asia, we have seen have taken such steps, asking countries to take back the trash which they have sent to the developing countries here. Then next is e-cigarettes pose public health risk, says ICMR. So, Indian Council of Medical Research has warned of potential public health disaster if action is not taken to completely prohibit and dissuade use of ENDS, that is electronic nicotine delivery systems, which are also popularly known as e-cigarettes. So, e-cigarettes, it is saying that it has adverse effect on cardiovascular system, respiratory immune cell functioning and airways, and also it is similar to cigarette smoking. So, it is responsible for severe respiratory diseases. So, e-cigarettes actually are promoted saying that it will help in giving up cigarettes. But then they have their own consequences, and they have also pose a risk to fetus, infant and child brain development. There may be DNA damage, carcinogenesis, cellular, molecular, immunological toxicity, respiratory, cardiovascular, neurological disorders. It can have adverse effect on fetal development in pregnancy too. So, it is said there are more than 460 different e-cigarette brands with varying configurations of nicotine delivery available in the market. So, ICMR, Indian Council of Medical Research, recommends complete prohibition on ENDS or e-cigarettes in India, because cigarette smoking in India has tobacco consumption, especially cigarette smoking, has shown a decline in India in recent years. And now these e-cigarettes are being promoted as by cigarette companies themselves, as they would help give up cigarettes. But the idea is that since cigarette manufacturing companies are seeing their sales declining, this is a new way in which they are attracting youths. So, youths get attracted to it. Vaping has become a yes, the slang as such too, and it is considered as trending and in fashion to use e-cigarettes. And e-cigarettes smokers may also eventually end up drinking, smoking cigarettes as such too. So this is a cause of concern, and ICMR rightly recommends complete prohibition on e-cigarettes in India in greater interest of protecting public health. So this is end. There are different ways in which it is done, like, you know, these are being shown here. So it's generally this is the e-cigarette. So e-liquid is used in the e-cigarettes. It's available in different flavors to attract youth as such too, you can see. So the ministry in India has decided to ban nicotine inhalers. Health ministry has announced this. You can see it has become a fashion statement among young tobacco users. So tobacco manufacturers have forayed into its manufacturing to offset shrinking sales on conventional cigarettes. So this is that. Then next is time to start studying females too. So US neurobiologist has said that earlier when she was conducting experiments in labs, she said that they were studying male mice only and females were not part of the study. Default was to study males. Why so? The primary excuse she said was that females were not included in research because hormones which females release just made everything so complicated. They said it was difficult if you try to study the brain in female animals. So such was the statements given. And in science, women were traditionally considered more complicated versions of men. So researchers believe that menstrual cycles and biological changes that went along with women, the woman's hormonal, emotional, the woman became hormonal, emotional and unstable study subjects. So it was preferred to have a male mice studied rather than a female. So because of this, what has happened is that the medicines which we have, drugs which have been developed in pharmaceutical labs, they are found beneficial for men, but in many cases women's bodies and brains respond to them differ. So they have not been tested on women. So it is said, but then the researcher also says that male mice also have their own hormonal changes. It is 1 to 5 times the level of testosterone which they have, depending on whether they are dominant or not. So scientists consider such changes as non-issues in males, but female biological changes, hormonal changes are considered an issue. So this bias is clearly evident in science as such too. But now research is emerging, new research is emerging that focuses on differences between the sexes. So even considering sex as a biological variable has been made mandatory. Also, there's an example given of how if a drug is manufactured considering only male mice, you know, on male studies. Like this is an example of sleep aid drug, Ambien. So this is a famous example because it causes more side effects in women than in men. So it turns out that women should actually be taking half the dose than men do because they metabolize the drug very early differently. So dosage recommendations for this Ambien drug, sleep aid drug, was changed in 2013. So that is when new field of research is emerging that focuses on differences between the sexes. And this is especially in case of anti-cancer treatments too now. So considering sex as a biological variable in research has now been made mandatory in various researches, like National Institute of Health requires this mandatory. So you can see this understudied creature is the key to solving women's number one killer, the lab mouse, and more importantly the female mice as such. So animals in medical research, it is said, are up to 5 times more likely to be male, and oddly enough women only make up 24% of participants in heart related studies too. So to understand women's heart diseases, we need to use the right research. So it's in all fields, in cancer treatment, in sleep aid, in heart diseases, we need to study more women. So that is where the research is required to now. And the last news is Japan unveils policy to curb plastic waste. So Japan has announced a policy to reduce marine plastic waste. So this is part of its efforts to raise the issue at G20 summit, which is going to take place at Osaka from 28th to 30th June. So Japan is said to be the second largest per capita producer of plastic waste in the world after USA. And it has comparatively high recycling rates, still it lags behind on the efforts to reduce single-use plastic. So now Japan also has plans to require retailers to charge customers for plastic bags. So such trend is also there in various countries, including in India too, many places. And European Union also in March 2019 passed legislation banning single-use plastics, including straws, cutlery from 2021. So such steps have been taken. Japan also has a policy to recycle 100% of newly produced plastics by 2035 and promote use of biodegradable alternatives to oil-based plastics. So plastic is manufactured from petroleum. So you should know that. So that's why it's called oil-based plastic. So it plans to support even Southeast Asian countries with recycling technologies and other infrastructure too. So these are Japan's plans on its action against plastic. It is said globally some 8 million tons of plastic waste is estimated to end up in the sea each year. So and from Japan it is around 20 to 60,000 tons of plastic waste which flows into oceans annually. So this is proposed to be tackled. So here you can see the proportion of plastic waste, quantity of plastic waste released in ocean by country is shown here. So from low to high. So here you can see China is high, the Southeast Asian countries. So number one is China, then comes Indonesia, Philippines, Vietnam, Sri Lanka. USA is at number 20, Japan comes at number 30. And where does the plastic in the oceans come from? Continent wise also it is shown. China is a major contributor. So even this is plastic garbage and tiny plastic fragments, microplastics. So plastic garbage as such is very high from India, China, Africa, East Asia. North America, it's microplastic, is very high, you can see. Even Europe, Central Asia, it's almost equal. Plastic and microplastic dumped into oceans. And in general, waste to solid waste generation, which countries generate the most waste per day? It is said USA comes number one, then comes China, then is Brazil, Japan, and number five is Germany. This is also a data. So that is it. This is the coverage for today. Thank you.